All right. Thank you for joining me for another edition of the Bob Sullivan Show. Today we have a local legend on the show, Nick Svehla, former basketball great from University of Nebraska, Kearney. How you doing today, Nick?
Doing well. Thanks, Bob. Good.
Well, we're getting into the that time of year where college basketball's starting to pick up. If you're a fan of Kearney basketball, you'll remember the day Nick Svehla hit the big shot to send Kearney, was it Elite Eight, right?
Elite Eight, yep.
In Lakeland, Florida, am I correct?
That's correct.
I still have that T-shirt, by the way, from when you guys went. Let's talk about that that senior season for you a little bit. Now you were a big deal. You were preseason All-American.
Bob, I'm still a big deal.
Well, still a big deal in my eyes, but
no, I'm only kidding. I was never too big of a deal, but
you were a preseason All-American, correct?
I think I was a preseason All-American, and I had a lot of good years in Kearney, and you know, I had some great teammates that really made the game fun, and you know, they kind of counted on me to score a little bit, so I was able to score the ball and have some rebounds, and yeah, I had a nice career there. It was a lot of fun.
Now your career, your game was pretty similar to a Kevin Love. Like, I mean, you could hit your threes. You had a mid-range jump shot, but you got a lot of garbage points, and that's how you survived a lot on garbage points.
That's probably a pretty good analogy. You know?
How are you, what do you think when you see Doug McDermott get all the attention he gets? Because that's his type of game, too. And that's where all his points come from. And he's obviously really good, but.
Yeah, he's an incredible player. I really do enjoy watching him play because, you know, he does a little bit of the inside and the outside game as well. And, you know, he's really, really an incredible player. And he's, you know, he's improved a lot since his freshman year. And it's fun to watch him train and play.
Do you think your game as far as what kind of toll does that take on your body playing that type of game?
It definitely takes its toll. The older I get, it's kind of funny because as I've gotten older, it's hard for me because I've lost so much of desire to play really, really hard, and so I think my game's gone south faster than probably other players that have enjoyed some, you know, some decent seasons.
Right. Has that taken a toll on your body in the? Is it harder to wake up in the morning these days than,
well, you know, luckily
because of playing that low post?
Luckily for me, it hasn't because I never suffered a major injury. So, I'm good to go right now. But hopefully, it stays that stays that way. And at 40, I'm not, you know, terrible knees and hard to get out of bed, bad back, and all that, you know, business. But yeah, I'll keep my fingers crossed here.
Now, the only game I've ever been to for UNK was that Sweet 16 game. And that was kind of a miracle run for, that team was already pretty loaded. But overall, I mean, what was that, the journey for you at UNK like to get to that point?
Well, We had a very average freshman year. I believe we were 16-12, and then my sophomore year we improved a lot. We had over 20 wins, and then junior and senior year we really started to get rolling. And I believe that senior season we ended up 30-3, and it was wild in that tournament because we had a really good team and we thought we could win every game, but it just so happened that you know, in the first round and second round and the third round of the tournament, we got down early. We were probably down double digits in each of those first three games. So, yeah, it was kind of a, you know, come from behind victory in all three of them.
Right. Now, the game, the Bob Sullivan show was at, that I was at, was the Sweet 16, and you guys were playing Metro State.
Mm-hmm.
It was a kind of a back and forth game early, and kind of, there was a point where it almost seemed like it was about to slip away. It always felt like there was just, like they were one shot away from breaking it open. What was the key to your guys' team to never let that happen to where you guys were you were always able to stay in games long enough that you could?
Well, you know, with Metro, they had ended our season two out of the previous 3 years, and they had won a couple national championships. I mean, we were really familiar. We knew exactly what they were going to do. They knew exactly what we were going to do. You know, there was no secret. And we knew it was going to be a game that was almost a guarantee to be within 5 points at the end. So we just figured if we kept clawing and, you know, keep fighting, we would have a decent shot at the end if we just, you know, made a play or two.
They were, they seemed like they didn't have, they were pretty physical down low, but you always knew, like, I kind of got the feeling that their guards were... there's always, like, their guard was always willing to, would always have a key turnover. There was a turnover towards the end that ended up leading to the moment we will get to here in a sec. What would you say their biggest weakness was that helped you guys finally beat them, get over that hump?
Oh, boy. Well, I mean, golly, when you've got two pretty good teams going at it, I'm not so much sure it's a weakness that they had or a potential weakness that we had. It's just really, when you get to a couple of good teams playing, it's more so, rather than who makes a mistake, a lot of times it's just, you know, who makes a really good play or a key bit me basket in a key situation. And, you know, I wouldn't say that there was, you know, necessarily a huge weakness on their team, but more so we just had, you know, a couple guys and fortunately in the right spot at the right time.
Right. So we get to about, I think it was about 15 seconds left. And Kearney's down by one, correct?
That is correct. Yep.
And now you're the Kearney, the Loper, Loper's best player, and gets out of the end. Clock's winding down. You pop out for a mid-range shot in the, I believe it was just off the block, correct, in the corner, and get hit with a pass, jump shot, take the lead with about, what was it, 3 or 4 seconds left.
I'm jogging my memory here. That sounds about right, though.
I think it's 3, 4 seconds, 5 seconds left. And they did not have a timeout. I believe that's correct. And so they had to run down the court and throw up a quick shot. What was that? How was your team able to control yourself? What, in that situation, if you're running a team, now you're a coach, obviously. Mm-hmm. What's that like as a player to be able to control your emotions, to hit a shot like that and know that you have to stop them on defense with 3 seconds left?
Well, I mean, that's the thing about it, is you really, it's kind of hard to think back about what's going through your mind, because there's really, your mind's kind of racing at that point. So, you know, I don't even know what was running through my mind at that point. And so, you know, as a coach now, I just try to, you know, tell the guys, hey, in certain situations, this is what we're going to do, and you really just got to hope that they do it, because they're, you know, they're probably not going to, you know, like I said, your mind's racing, you're probably really not going to know what to do, doesn't you know, catch a pass and hit a shot at the buzzer to kind of, you know, take away all your glory or whatnot.
Right. That was right. Now that was, so Nebraska was able to live out two great moments, the Terrell Taylor and then the following year, your shot. I'd say, I mean, yours was in a bigger moment to send yourself to bigger, to send yourself to a bigger game, but that one gets lost in the shuffle a little bit.
Well,
I mean,
obviously. You know, with Creighton being, you know, a Division I Missouri Valley school, and you know, Kearney being a Division II school, you know, you don't get as much of the, you know, Nebraska attention, especially being in Omaha, you know. And growing up, I didn't hear a whole lot about Kearney. You know, really, when you get to the eastern part of the state here, some kids, even in my high school, couldn't even tell you where Kearney is. So,
right.
You know, we just don't get the publicity out in Omaha. But, you know, that's all right, too.
Is it true you can't spell drunk without UNK? Is that true?
That's one of the famous Kearney lines.
Okay.
Can't spell drunk without UNK. That is definitely a line that people have thrown out there.
Now, did you ever get the opportunity to play in an exhibition against Nebraska?
Yeah, we did. When I was a sophomore, we played Nebraska in an exhibition game.
So that would have been Danny Nee would have been still there. I
think it was. No, it wasn't. Danny Nee was not there. It was one of the, yeah, Collier was there, yeah.
Was that blast for you? How did that?
I mean, it was a blast. I mean, we, you know, it's one of those typical underdogs. You know, you feel like, you know, nobody gives you a chance. You know, it's one of those things where we really had nothing to lose. And, you know, Nebraska had a pretty good, you know, they were a pretty decent team that year. And, you know, it came down to the wire. We had, you know, we had a shot to win it at the end. And it just so happened we didn't make a shot at the end. But we felt pretty decent about, you know, how we played. And actually, to be honest with you, we really didn't feel decent about how we played because we
thought you were better.
Oh, we thought we were better for sure. You know, there was no question in our mind. I mean, we our field goal percentage was awful.
Right.
We didn't feel like we gave them our best shot. And you know, we would love to play them again, but you know, just with the, you know, you get your one shot and you either get it or you don't. And unfortunately for us, we didn't get it.
What do you think of a team like, now those games, their exhibition, how did Nebraska play that game? Because they don't have the right, especially with Collier coaching them, and even now, they don't have the right to take anybody lightly. How did they play that game? Did they
play a
real game?
I would assume, you know, I don't know what their mindset was coming in, but as far as, you know, if it's me and it's my attitude, it didn't matter who we played, whether we played, you know, a Division II school, an NAIA school, Division I school. I came out and had the same mindset every game. I wanted to, you know, play as hard as I could and play well and try to win. So I'm sure Nebraska came out and wanted to win that game. It's just the fact that we had more of a chip on our shoulder than they did.
Right.
And that's like, you know, any smaller school versus a big school, they always have an advantage that they've got the chip on their shoulder. And it just so happens sometimes when a smaller school really has some pretty good talent, they can pull off the upset and get some decent wins.
Right. Brent Heller was a year younger than you, right?
Mm-hmm, correct.
And he went to Bellevue. Did you ever play against him when they were...
You know, we never played Bellevue when I was in Kearney.
Because I know NAIA sometimes plays the B2.
Yeah, Kearney's played Bellevue since, but we just never had him on the schedule back then.
So who's the better Omaha product as far as, do you wish you would have had Heller so you could have had a little Rubio combination?
I played with Frank quite a bit since we both graduated from college, and he's probably one of the scrappiest players I've ever played with or against, and yeah, he'd always for sure be an asset.
Yeah, I've never seen anybody be able to smoke like three cigarettes and then go play basketball.
Oh yeah, or wear some, you know, I don't even know what kind of shoes he wears. He wears some
Oh, the untied ones?
The untied shoes that look like, you know, your grandfather would have worn them. So, yeah. It's something else.
He's still as fast as he was back. Have you been to... Do you go to Kearney games at all anymore?
I try to catch a game or two each year. It's really nice when they come to UNO and play. They'll play UNO February 15th. I'll be at that game. And then I try to get out to Kearney once a year and catch a game. You know, with our basketball schedule in Omaha, it's sometimes tough for me to get away. You know, it almost has to end up being like a Tuesday night or something. But, you know, I like to get out there for a game.
Is Coach Croft still out there?
Coach Croft's still coaching, yeah.
How's he doing? How's the team been doing since you...
You know, he's doing well, and the team is, you know, has been up and down a little bit. You know, a few years after I left, they had some really good seasons, and then, you know, they had, you know, a few average seasons in between, and now this year they seem to be having a pretty good year. So, you know, I try to keep up as much as I can, and, you know, it gets tough, though. The older I get, the tougher it gets to check them out and see what's going on there.
Is he upset that he has yet to be on ESPN First Take for having a child and then going to coach a game like the women's basketball coach at Kearney did?
You know what? I don't think he has any issue with that. He's definitely not a guy that's looking for the television spotlight or anything like that. But yeah, that was pretty fun about.
That was great. What do you think of the UNO move to Division One? Did you hate UNO when you much of a rivalry there?
There was. I didn't hate UNO. It was one of those things where, you know, I was either going to go to UNO or I was going to go to Kearney. And, you know, I decided to go to Kearney, and so when I played against UNO, it always meant a little bit more for me, you know, being from Omaha, and, you know, it was more of a rivalry for me, and I kind of actually probably was a little bit too emotionally out of control when I played against UNO. But I think it's a good move. I mean, you know, you feel bad for those football players and, you know, the wrestlers, but I don't know. From a selfish standpoint, I'm going to go watch some more UNO basketball now that they're Division One. So
I wish they played at the Civic, but
that
4,000 seater would be sweet. So.
Oh yeah, what is that in Ralston?
Yeah, they're moving there, and I think the Lancers or something.
Uh huh. So. No, I'll definitely go to a couple. You know, if I can, I'll go to a few UNO games and kind of support them. They've got a handful of prep kids up there on the team. So
were you ever a Creighton fan growing up, or
I was a Creighton fan. I would catch a few games. You know, my dad's a Creighton grad.
You were able to see the great Rick Johnson in years. Right.
I saw some of the Rick Johnson years, but really I didn't go to a whole lot of games, really. You know, the first games I actually can remember going to were some of the games Buford played in. And so, you know, my family, we didn't go to games growing up. I didn't start going to games until I was like in high school, and I'd go with a friend or, you know.
Did you ever
like
get
that.
Forced to go with my brother Danny to any Racers games?
I did, absolutely. I went with Danny to probably one or two Racer games. I think they had Legler back then.
Legler, Chad Gallagher.
Oh, yeah, Gallagher too. Yeah.
Who else is the one that he always talks about? I know he always talks about the Starks coming into play.
Uh-huh.
Like,
it's funny, they have the old quarter points or whatever. Racer days.
Yeah, he still talks about that. I mean, it's funny that he talks about that, but the NBA should look at going to that, because
that might spice things up a little bit.
Yeah, there needs.
I'm not a big NBA regular season guy anyway. I just.
Yeah. Gotten tough this year.
Yeah, I'd like to see him cut the season to about 40 games, make every game worthwhile, and then, you know, go to the playoffs.
Yeah, I think they need to cut two teams.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. Absolutely, if not four.
What would you think of cutting two, consolidating four teams into two, or consolidating four teams into two teams and then cutting two additional teams?
Oh, for sure.
Eliminate. What is it? Essentially, 45 players that shouldn't be in the NBA, like a Baron Davis. And he's supposed to be the savior for the Knicks this year. I'm going to kill myself if that's the case. But, I mean, yeah, it's too long a season. There's too many teams. There's too many bad players.
Yeah, and, you know, honestly, I don't even blame the, you know, people always say the guys in the NBA don't play hard. One, I don't buy that. But,
I don't either.
But two, I just don't think people don't realize how the wear and tear of the NBA season on a body.
Go play two games in three nights. Go play back-to-back, a night game followed by a day game in the afternoon.
Right, and they're 48-minute games.
Right.
I mean, there's people just don't really realize. But the problem is, it's perception is reality. The fan doesn't realize that, so the average fan just says, hey, they don't play hard. So,
well, I would say that there's quarters. If somebody, like, I'll argue that Baron Davis, there's circumstances where you can say, okay, that player's not playing hard. But when they say, like, if, like, a Kobe or somebody like Iverson's taking a day off, that was the biggest, like, joke whenever anybody said he would take days off, because that wasn't because, I mean, he would never take days off. It was always because he's so banged up, because he'd run into the lane and get hammered every time.
Oh, yeah.
Go to the free throw line 15 times a night as a guard. I mean,
his body. Oh, yeah, that it does. It really takes its toll. I mean, those guys, I mean, outside of football players, and I suppose I don't know much about hockey, but I'm sure those guys get banged up too, but 82 games is just, it's a grind.
Yeah. Mentally, how are you in college? What was that, the daily grind like for you to have to?
Well, you know, I can remember even talking to coaches and saying, you know, just kind of, you know, it takes a toll on you, you know. Even when you're winning games, it's like, man, the season just seems never ending. It's just so long. You know, you're throwing a Christmas break in there. It seems just incredibly long.
Right.
But, it is. It's a mental grind. You got to, to a certain extent, you got to get through it. Because it is tough.
How did you go from, like, a day in, day out? Like, what did you have to do to be able to play? You said you never had a major injury.
Mm-hmm.
You never had to sit out. But, Division 2 doesn't have the facilities that Division 1 has. Like, they're not going to have, like, the massage chairs and stuff. So you're going to have to do...
You want a cup of pizza?
Sure. Thanks.
Pip and water or just pip?
Just pip.
Okay.
So
no food, right? Can I make up a check?
Yep, that's fine. But, like, there's not the facilities. Like, there's no massage chairs. No, but you have to do, like, I mean, you're going to have to go in 20 minutes early to get stim or something before practice, or take, like, a hot shower in the dorms or whatever. I mean, go to bed early, take some ibuprofen. Those are the ways to get through.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of, you know, especially in the preseason, a lot of sitting in the cold whirlpool. Definitely had my fair share of, like, the stim treatment, the ultrasounds. I haven't thought about that for years. But, yeah, I guess I had a lot of that stuff. And, it's just, yeah, you, the demand on your body is pretty high, so.
Thank you.
Yep.
What was your favorite memory of a, outside of the sending your team to Elite Eight in Lakeland, Florida, what was your favorite memory outside of that?
You know, that's a good question. I've got just a ton of good memories. It's really hard to pinpoint one. I just, looking back at it, I always think about how fortunate I was to play, number one, play at Kearney, for the coaches I played for, but then I just had some phenomenal teammates. I mean, guys that I still hang out with today and still talk to on a regular basis. And, just really an incredible stroke of luck to be able to, you know, not just go play pretty good basketball, but play with some guys that were just solid guys that I, you know, still hang out with today, you know.
Do you, what do you miss the most about playing at Kearney?
Probably the competition. I mean, there's really nothing else in life that can really replicate the feeling you get when you are 20 minutes away from tipping off. And it's just a different adrenaline rush, you know. It's not very often you get a rush like that. And, you know, even coaching, it's different. It's a different rush. It's just, you know, that's probably what I miss the most, just going out there competing and just loving that part of it.
Who was your biggest personal rival? What player did you despise the most on another team, or did you have a rival, like a personal rival?
You know, in college, I probably really didn't have a huge rival.
How about a team that you hated?
Probably Metro State, Fort Hays, just because they were both in our conference. They were both really good teams. Metro, because they were, you know, they're so darn good. We lost a lot of games to Metro. And they had some really good years. I believe they won the national championship my freshman and junior year. So they were always kind of the top dog. So
did you guys meet them in the RMAC championship, or did you meet them in the conference tournament this year?
I think we did. Golly, I feel like we might have played them four times that year. Maybe it was only three. I can't remember, because in my senior year, we lost in the conference tournament to Fort Hays. So I'm not sure if we actually ended up playing Metro.
What kind of feeling was that? I mean, they're basically your Metro State's the bully of the conference, essentially. I mean, you guys are, I mean, that was the pinnacle, 30-3 that year for Kearney. And Metro State's always been it's almost, I guess, like when, I don't know, if the Bulls getting past the Pistons, I guess.
Right.
Something like that. What was that, finally getting that burden of getting past that team that's ended your season 2 out of 3 years?
Yeah, you know, it's kind of funny because I only remember, I always tell people I have a terrible memory. I don't really remember plays and games all that well.
Yeah.
But I do remember one time in the Kearney Hub, the newspaper there, they had a headline that said, "Enough is enough." And I guess I said that back then. You know, when we beat Metro to go to the Elite Eight, I must have made a quote, you know, saying enough is enough, and, you know, we finally kind of got over the hump. And but I mean, there was a lot of respect there, and they were a really good team. I mean, they were a really good team, and they earned our respect. They were tough.
How great a feeling was it to finally to be able to stop taking bus rides, to be able to fly to Florida for that?
You know, we only took two flights ever in Kearney. One was to Hawaii and one was to Florida. So it was nice. It was nice to get on the plane. Some of those bus rides were like 20-hour. I believe the longest was a 24-hour trip in a snowstorm. And but, you know, I'll tell you what, I wouldn't replace that for plane rides either, because, you know, even though sometimes you line up at 4 a.m. and you can't sleep, you know, those are some of the best times to just kind of hang with the teammates and get to know some guys and just hang out. So I would never replace those bus rides. I look back fondly at them. I might like them, but it was a great, it was a great maturing experience. And just great to hang out with the guys.
How were you able to when you're a freshman, how tough is that to get used to those getting off the bus and immediately having to, it wouldn't be immediate, but you do take 2-3 hour bus rides and you're a tall guy, you're sitting in a crappy bus and you're ass to ankles in the bus. I mean, how did you get ready for those games?
I don't think it ever bothered me too much personally. you know, our coach was a pretty hard-nosed guy. And, you know, he was never going to accept an excuse. And, you know, I just kind of had that mentality, too. I played with, you know, specifically I can remember in high school more so than college, but guys that would get all bent out of shape about riding a bus for an hour and, you know, worried about what their legs would feel like. But me, it's almost mental more than anything. I didn't think it ever played much of a big deal. Now, as I get older, you know, I've played with some buddies, and we've kind of gone around, and we played some, you know, NAIA teams and some other teams, and it takes a toll now that I'm older. But back then, I don't think it mattered too much.
So do you play on one of those exhibition teams?
We do an exhibition team. We play, you know, just some local schools. We play quite a few. You know, we play Bellevue every year. We play Midland. We play, gosh, Dana before it closed. We played Mount Marty,
yeah.
Morningside, you know.
Have you played Mount Marty colleges in the last couple of years, or has it been a while?
Like I said, my memory's terrible, but I think we played them last year.
So you're essentially like the, what's it called? The Harlem Globetrotters is the...
Minus the skills of the Globetrotters.
Right.
We're just kind of an old crew. But, you know, we're an old crew that kind of knows how to play, and we end up doing pretty well.
How much fun are those games? What do you see? And, I mean, you're from the generation that grinded out generation of basketball. Like, you were at the... You grew up mostly in the 80s and 90s watching NBA. That the NBA you grew up watching was win a game. You're not going to score 100 points.
Right.
You're going to have to – it's going to be 66 to 65 games going into the fourth quarter, and it's not going to be pretty. And I grew up watching that with, like, the Knicks and stuff. And so, me watching the Big Ten now is frustrating because – if I would have watched the Big Ten in the 90s, I would have loved it because I love the NBA back then. But I've gotten so used to the NBA, which I watch all the time, and I've gotten so used to the NBA that 100 is, if you don't score 100, you're not going to make the playoffs.
Right, right.
So now I'm like, well, I like Big 12, Big East. What? So you were in that era of knowing how to grind it out, and you enjoyed rebounding. You enjoyed doing rebound putbacks. Nobody enjoys doing that anymore. What do you see in the players you're playing against where it's all guard play?
Well, that's funny because, you know, I'm kind of going through this battle right now with some of my JV players.
Everybody wants to shoot a three now.
Yeah, people want to shoot a three. I don't know. I just think maybe I'm too hard on the players, but I just don't see the toughness that you know, maybe I saw playing back when I played. You know, it's just, you know, that's a tough pill to swallow because to me, if there's one thing you want, it's your guys to play tough. And, you know, whether you win or lose, you know, at least you can say you were giving it all you had. But, I mean, for the most part, you know, we've got guys, you know, I'm not talking about my coaching experience. We got, you know, I wouldn't trade the guys we've got for anyone in the world, but, you know, and I think it is. I don't think it's just one school. I think it's definitely a little bit more prevalent now, guys that are, you know, kind of maybe looking a little bit more and grind it out a little bit less.
So who would you rather coach, a Creighton-type team, Creighton right now, with, like, a lot of golf? Well, that's bad. Steve Nash type team with, like, a lot of scoring, a lot of passing, guard oriented, no big guy. Or would you rather coach like a Southern Illinois type team from like Randall Falk or Rachel Hayden with physical guard, kind of an Oakley type, like bully you into a grinded out game, or do you want something in the middle there?
Well, I must be kind of an idiot because I actually prefer to run and gun, and that's probably not the best strategy ever. You've got to play some defense if you want to win.
Yeah.
But I mean, I I can't stand watching basketball where, you know, you burn 30 seconds off the shot clock and get a shot, or, you know, you just slow down the game, or, you know, some high school coaches will just grind out a minute off the clock. I mean, to me, I just, number one, I think there should be a shot clock in high school basketball.
Some state tried it. Do you think Nebraska will get to that, or is it a monetary issue, or what do you think?
I think it's a monetary issue, but, you know, I don't know. There's probably bigger fish to fry, but to me, a shot clock is a pretty big deal. I mean, I'm kind of under the belief that you want to give the best team a chance to win. And really, with no shot clock, you really give lesser teams a better chance of winning, because, you know, you can slow the game down, you can create less possessions, and you can, you know, essentially just hope that the team has an off night and they only get, you know, 35, 40 possessions in a game, and maybe you can get lucky. So, but I hate it. I hate that. I hate that style of basketball.
It really, I mean, I don't think talent conquers all, but it usually doesn't basketball, but in, you shouldn't be allowed. I mean, shot clock needs to happen in high school. Do you think it's kind of weird how, like there's always been kind of a conspiracy of corruption in, like, pro sports. It's kind of, there's no conspiracy. There is corruption in college sports. It's starting to get into high school sports. Do you think there's any going back? I mean, there's kids getting, like, more and more, there's more of a kid's self-entitlement. And I don't know if it's the era, or if it's just because, if it's ever going to change, if there's, like, no turning back because of the media and whatnot.
Yeah.
But what do you think? Is there any way to change that?
You know, I don't know. Part of the problem, I think, is some of these kids get too much attention at a young age and are, you kind of get a big head too early, and then you don't develop probably as well as you should, and it just seems to be that age keeps getting younger, and golly, you know, I don't know, I don't know where it's all headed. But
I'm coaching baseball, JV baseball. I mean, it's like, I don't get the parents anymore. I mean, it's almost like, I mean, they grew up during the time when the parents now, or they grew up when it was tough. Like, they didn't grow up in the Great Depression, but they grew up during, like, the 70s, the bad times in the 70s. And, I mean, they had the coaches that are, like, they knew the Bobby Knights and all of that. I don't know how the kids have been just able to get under the impression and then the parents are always complaining, like, oh, my kid got sworn at. That's unbelievable. What did your coach say to you back in the day?
Well, I definitely played for some guys that were some, you know, they definitely had some, I guess you would say, colorful vocabulary. I try actually not to cuss too much.
Well, I don't think you need to.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's necessary to get off. It's not necessary, but
I agree. I mean, for sure agree, because in my 7 years of coaching, I think I cursed one time. One time.
Wow.
Well, because I used to...
I think in my 1 year of coaching, I've touched over 700 times.
You know, I had a rule, though, that if kids cursed, it was a $5 fine.
Mm-hmm.
I told them if I cursed, it was like a $100 fine or $50. I can't remember what it was, but, you know, I'm getting soft, Bob, because I didn't incorporate that rule this year. And looking back, I'll incorporate it again next year.
Yeah.
Because I think part of it is learning self-control, especially for the kids. I mean, you know, I understand being frustrated, and I understand. But one thing I do always say is that there was times when I was in high school that I was acting a bit crazy, and I wish my coach would have ran me in a little bit more. Just because looking back, you know, I probably acted like an idiot. So, you know, but I understand a high school kid, you know, the maturity level, and the, you know, you're in the heat of the battle, and it's sometimes it's tough, you know. So.
Now, who was in the running for your for you when you who was recruiting you when you went to college and.
The main recruit, you know, I had it narrowed down to UNO and Kearney. You know, some other schools were looking at me. You know, Hastings was looking at me. Dome, Midlands, all the kind of NAIA schools around. Probably some other ones too. I can't remember.
Good. Now, you didn't make your decision until it was probably after your senior year basketball.
That's correct. Yep.
What do you think of all these kids deciding? Or, like, I mean, Brad Metzler, who I had on the show, second show, was his sister just signed a letter or gave her commitment to Nebraska. She's a freshman for softball.
Freshman in high school?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And she committed, like, before her softball season started. So she was technically in eighth grade when she committed to Nebraska.
Mm-hmm.
What? I mean, I don't get all this deciding you have to know where to go.
Yeah, I mean, I probably would not recommend that just because a lot can change in 3 or 4 years. So I certainly wouldn't recommend that. You know, if someone decides that, you know, there's no other place in the world for me, I suppose that's okay. But I mean, I agree with you to a certain standpoint. I mean, I don't know how you know that in eighth grade, you know.
Yeah.
But.
Last thing before we get going here. Who's the answer, Nebraska? Did you watch that game last night?
The Indiana Nebraska game? I didn't watch it.
I was there.
Uh-huh.
I was disgusted because my insider for Nebraska Hoops is one of their managers, Colin Higgins. And
okay.
So I had to go down to that game. Halfway through the game, I was rooting for Nebraska when I got there, and I couldn't keep rooting for them because their fans are so stupid. Like, it's like they're football fans that don't know football come over to the basketball games and don't know basketball.
Yeah.
So I had to listen to that. So I bet I started rooting for Nebraska or for Indiana and being obnoxious about it. But then Nebraska comes back and wins. And I did meet Eddie Johnson and Eric Strickland after the game.
Oh, okay.
There was no reaction when Strickland was announced. Like, at all. Like, I don't understand. Where's the appreciation?
Right,
he won
right.
them the NIT.
Well, yeah, I mean,
and he was an NBA player.
Right. One of the better players that, you know, ever played in Nebraska.
And, but that's beside the point. They're not going to get it together. They've been bad for 15 years. There's no recognition of the ton are accomplished. No banner for the NIT. No banner for the Big 8 title. But you know where those are?
Storage, I guess. I don't know.
No, they're not posted in the Devaney Center. Those are posted in their practice facility, in their practice gym, where nobody goes.
That's brilliant. That's interesting. Yeah, I don't know.
And who's the answer? Where? I don't think Doc can get it done.
Well, you know, I to be honest with you, I don't really follow Nebraska basketball.
You're lucky, because.
Yeah, but, you know, the answer is just, you know, it's always
going to be. But I have Chris is keeping an eye on you. She has a blue shirt on.
Okay.
So she'll be coming by. I'm sure you've seen her a couple times already. So
have
a good night. Thank you for coming in.
Thanks, Jesse.
Yep.
No, I was just going to say, I mean, to me, you win with recruits. And so, you know, it's been hard for Nebraska to get, you know, consistently get big-time recruits in. And that, you know, that's kind of the answer in my mind at least.
Okay. Do you, like, that practice facility is amazing. And it's amazing that I didn't know they still had those banners, but I guess they do. I'd say, others, they've used the recruit argument so much. Like, we can't get these recruits here. But all the while, I mean, like, Kansas State's passed them again. I mean, like, I don't know who, they got to get somebody that can, like, I mean, Doc was supposed to be the answer, and he doesn't look like he can do it. They've tried the mid-major coach route. That doesn't work.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Twice. And they've tried both styles of laid-back coach and a hard-nosed coach. Like, neither one of them worked. I think they got to get a cheater. Well, first pick Pearl.
Well,
yeah. He didn't really cheat, but...
Yeah, I don't know.
But, I mean, Spencer, he's a good player, but they just need... if he can play like he did last night, I think they got role players to get to make a run in the NIT, but they're not. They'll be lucky to make the NIT at this point.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything else you want to talk about before we go, or
Bob? I don't know what to tell you. I don't have a whole lot else. I will tell you this: I get a common question. The kids over the years have asked me, they've seen some things online about my old playing days.
Mm-hmm.
I'm getting to be pretty much irrelevant because it's been so long since I played, but I always get a question at least twice a year. The question goes, Mr. Svehla, is it true that you once broke a backboard?
Oh.
And I always give them the famous answer of no. And I look them right in the eye and I say, I've broken two.
Really? Is that true?
That's a true story. It's a true story, yeah.
Really? Did you break one at prep?
I did not. I broke one at Lincoln East.
Really?
In the Cornhusker State games, and then one at Kearney.
Really?
Yeah.
I did not know that. Was it from hanging, or was it? Were you?
You know, it was. It was. It was nothing more than a stroke of
chocolate just, thunder.
Yeah. No. I mean, it was just. it was just a complete random. You know it. Both backboards were just ready to go, and I was certainly no power dunker, that's for sure.
So you didn't go up looking to...
Oh, absolutely not. Absolutely not. It was just something crazy that happened. It's like lightning striking twice. It was certainly not because I was jumping out of the gym and throwing down hammer power dunks or anything like that. But
how did that feel? Like, did you pull, or did it just all... Luckily,
I never fell down. Yeah, I was able to kind of come down and kind of run out of the way. And, you know, I've got a couple scars on my shoulder that are just little glass, pieces of glass getting stuck in there. But, you know, other than that, luckily I didn't get hurt with it.
So it wasn't like in Cable Guy?
No, not quite. Not quite.
Well, Nick, I'm glad I could have you on here.
Yeah,
you're welcome on any time. We'll have to, for sure, after Kearney season's over, we'll rehash the great... Actually, we'll rehash it on the anniversary. How about that?
Sounds good.
And thank you for joining us for that installment. And look up on YouTube, Nick Svehla, game-winning shot against Metro State. Thank you for joining us.